Zoroastrianism Ancient and Modern. By Phiroze Shapurju Masani. Edited by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 8 of 16. Chapter 5. The writer's fondness for animal sacrifices said to have been encouraged in Zoroastrianism. In the last main head we have seen how the writer of Zoroastrian theology eagerly refers to foreign writers pro-animal sacrifices said to have been practiced by Zoroastrians. In this chapter we shall deal with the subject of animal sacrifices, and we shall see whether Zoroastrian scriptures have encouraged the practice of animal slaughter, by referring to various Avesta texts. The writer of Zoroastrian theology has throughout attempted to make the reader believe that all the so-called later Avesta texts have inculcated the doctrine of giving animal sacrifices to angels and emanations of Ahura Mazda. By this attempt he further wants to show that the later Avesta texts, since they preach the doctrine of animal slaughter, cannot have been given by the prophet. With the uniform motive of running down all the so-called later Avesta texts, the writer of Zoroastrian theology has, as we have seen throughout all the heads, tried his best to dupe his reader into this belief. If the later Avesta texts are thus depreciated, there remains simply the religion as taught in the five gathas, and the people of the class of the writer of Zoroastrian theology do require a religion without the Asna, the Vendidad, the Yashts, and all other Avesta except the gathas. To start with, we must bear in mind that the idea of animal sacrifices as taught by the writer of Zoroastrian theology is never to be found in any Avesta scriptures, whether Gathic or non-Gathic. Very often we find that the word sacrifice, as used in its degraded sense in English in the phrase animal sacrifice or killing of an animal in the name of religion, has been quite absurdly put for the Avesta word yasna. The word sacrifice, from its Latin derivation sacer, holy, and facio, I make, literally signifies the holy process, the holy procedure, or holy making, i.e. procedure of holiness. Hence it further adopted the meaning of a sacred offering or offering for higher or more holy objects. In support or this tracing of meanings we may quote two authorities, Webster and Century Dictionaries. Webster gives the three meanings in order thus. The offering of anything to God or to a deity. Consecratory rite. An immolated victim presented in the way of religious thanksgiving, atonement, or conciliation. The Century Dictionary explains the term sacrifice as under. Literally, a rendering sacred. That which is sacrificed, specially that which is consecrated and offered to a deity as an expression of thanksgiving, consecration, penitence, or reconciliation. Thus we see that the meaning of animal slaughter assigned to the term sacrifice in its degraded sense was never the original meaning thereof. Apart from the meaning of the English word, we must say that yas or yasna in the Avesta never means sacrifice or animal slaughter. Otherwise, as the writer of Zoroastrian theology takes the word yasna to mean animal sacrifice, the entire Avesta with the gathas, which are full of the various forms of yas and yasna, would be absurdly inculcating the slaughter or sacrifice of everything and every angel, emanation of Ahura Mazda, man, beast, plant, etc., with which the word yas is to be found attached. The words yas and yasna may have been translated by some Western scholars perhaps in the original higher sense of sacrifice or sacred rendering, but the writer of Zoroastrian theology translates yas or yasna in the degraded sense of animal sacrifice or slaughter. Some scholars have taken the word yas to mean worship, praise, or propitiate, which is much nearer to the original meaning of yas. Yas means to attune oneself with, to be en rapport with, to be univibrant with, and the ceremonial bringing the result of attunement or univibrancy is called yasishna or yasna ceremony. We are at a loss to understand why the writer of Zoroastrian theology has used the term yasna in such a base and degraded sense of sacrifice. He says, the sacrificing priest invites him to attend a yasna sacrifice. As quoted from yasna. Here we see a very strange compound noun formed, namely, yasna sacrifice. That the word yasna never implies any idea of animal or other sacrifice is very clearly seen from the yenhi hatem formula, which has the same significance as the Yatha Ahu Vario and the Hashem Vohu prayers. In the formula it is taught that we must attune ourselves with all those who are advancing on the path of spiritual unfoldment and who are known by Ahura Mazda as the best in Yasna or attunement with Ahura Mazda. In all the gathas we find the word yasna only in the one ideal sense of spiritual attunement of the devotee with the spiritual forces and intelligences, and the idea of animal sacrifice forced onto the word yasna is only the zenith of so many queer innovations of the writer of Zoroastrian theology on account of his peculiar idols of the mind. Now we shall first quote or refer to a number of passages from the entire Avesta scriptures in order to prove that the idea of slaughter of animals or animal sacrifice is quite foreign to the Zoroastrian scriptures. After this we shall refer to the arguments advanced by the writer of Zoroastrian theology in favor of animal sacrifices. I. Direct references con slaughter of animals, and pro-vegetarian diet for man. Protection of the animal creation, their care and nourishment, their rescue and relief. I. Gatha section, O Ahura Mazda, the entire living creation is protected by Vo human in thy kingdom. 2. Gatha section, Ahura Mazda brands as evil those who dissuade men from doing best things and who voluntarily advocate the killing of the animal creation, Jishmorandan. 3. Gatha section, the oppressor who ruins his life through his wicked actions prevents the helpers of Ashoy and the animal creation from moving about. He who stops such a wicked person from so doing will set free the animal creation and the store of the good food of wisdom. 4. Gatha section, he who procures power for the wicked sinner, and he who is not fit for living his life on account of his harassing the animal creation and a truthful man, I inquire about such, O Mazda. V. Gatha section, the Karups, i.e. the sinners, in spite of spiritual knowledge can never achieve any ideal thing. They never preach the protection of the animal creation either by word or by practice. On account of this characteristic of theirs they shall go to the abode of Druje or evil influence. 6. Gatha section, O Ahura Mazda, inform me if there is anybody as the protector of my animals, Pasushthreta, except thyself, Vo human and Ardi Behesht. 7. Gatha section, O Ahura Mazda, may I remove from thyself by means of prayer the extreme negligence regarding the fodder of the cattle creation. 8. Yasna section, may I protect the animal creation from the thief and the robber by means of prayer, offered unto Ahura Mazda. 9. Yasna section, we attune ourselves with the entire animal sea farvardhan yasht section animal creation, e.g. the water animals, the land animals, the birds, the free-moving animals, the hoofed animals. X. Yasna section, salutations to the cattle creation. Salutations to Vo human yasht section the animal creation. Good word to the animal creation. Success to the cattle creation. Food to the animal creation. Apparel for the animal creation. We attune ourselves with the souls of the beneficent cattle and beasts. Ought to be working for the animal creation, and they are the renderers of prosperity for our food. 11. Vendidad section, I salutations to thee, O prosperity rendering animal, whom the wicked heretic unholy, cruel man slaughters. 12. Yasna section, I shall keep thy soul from hell if thou repeat at the moment of thy death the words of invocation of the entire animal creation, e.g. the water animals, the land animals, the birds, etc. 13. Farvardhan yasht section, we attune ourselves with the souls of animus and beasts, e.g. water animals, land animals, birds, leapers, hoofed animals, etc. 14. Yasna sections. 15. Yasna section, we attune ourselves with the souls of major hoftan yasht section ourselves and of the beast creation which desires to exist for our sake, and we are for them just as they are for us. 16. Gatha section, we must work for the cattle creation, for they are renderers of abundance and prosperity for our food, and they are our precious belonging. They bestow strength and power in our noble aspirations. Ahura Mazda, let the vegetation grow for them through Asha from the beginning of this creation. 17. Gatha section, he is well disposed towards the Holy One, and he who skillfully protects his animal, is as it were engaged in doing deeds of holiness and good thought. 18. Yasna section, we consider for you the Yasna of Ahura Major Hoftan Yasht section Mazda and the nourishment of the cattle creation as the best. Verily shall we act according this and teach the same in accordance with our wishes. 19. Gatha section, May Ahura Mazda grant strength for increasing the prosperity of our men and cattle. XX, Yasna section, we desire happiness and fodder for the major Hoftan Yasht section cattle through charity and best actions. XXI, Farvardhan Yasht section, may there be an increase of cattle and men in this house, where we the Fravishi are invoked. Vendidat Fargard section, may there be an increase of cattle and men Adishnaish section unto you, who invoke me i.e. the fire. XXIII, Manaish section, ye full glorid angels. O ye health-giving angels! Give courage and victory unto me, grant increase of cattle unto me. XXIV, Mitihara Yasht section, the angel Mitihara bestows increased cattle and men into that abode where he is propagated. Druje Inasu i.e. evil magnetic influence accompanying a corpse or a carcass, flesh blood, pus etc. When dissociated from vitality fall under the influence of Druje Inasu i.e. demon of putrefaction or Druje Ihikar i.e. demon of disintegration, the carcass or dead body of an animal from which the vital principle has gone out is verily termed Nasu in the Vendidad, and seclusion from such Nasu is strictly enjoined. Vendidad Fargard section, those who produce Nasu are wicked and demoniac, for they destroy cattle and lengthen the deep snowed, cruel, injurious, winter. This subject is very well known to the students of Zoroastrian religion, and the Vendidad is so teeming with references to Nasu that it would be superfluous here to quote a long list. The vegetable kingdom is the source of natural food for man. I, Gatha section, Orvidat and Amrita will both serve thee for food. 2. Jamayad Yasht section, Orvidat, the intelligence presiding over water will quench thirst, and Amrita presiding over vegetation will appease hunger. 3. Vendidad section, I who am Ahura Mazda send down rain for the nourishment of men and for the food of useful cattle. Grain and corn is the food for men, grass and fodder will be the food for animals. 4. Tishtraya Yasht section, O ye countries, be ye prosperous. Henceforth the food of the entire world, e.g. grain and corn requiring much water for its growth, and vegetables requiring a little water, come out of the earth unobstructed. V. Farvardhan Yasht section, there on this earth spring and river water flows, where many kinds of trees grow from out the earth, for the nourishment of animals and men, for the nourishment of the country of Iran, for tile nourishment of the five species of animals and for the help of the holy man. 2. Agriculture is the best occupation according to Zoroastrianism, farming increases holiness, I, Yasna section. I invoke the most industrious and the prosperity-rendering farmer who works most for the fodder of cattle. 2. Vendidad section. Hormuzd replied O Spitaman Zarathustra, that land is the most joyous on which are cultivated grain and fodder and fruit-giving trees. 3. Vendidad section. Hormuzd replied, the proper cultivation of grain is the advancement of the Mazdaiznian law. 4. Vendidad section. O man, I whom thou cultivatest shall come to thy country and bring the food of fruits and grain. V. Visparid section. I invoke by means of the libation and sacred twigs the storer of fodder, the farmer who produces fodder for the cattle, and the holy man who nourishes the cattle. 6. Vendidad section. He who cultivates grain makes himself as happy as one who performs 10,000 yasna. 3. The Ashoi or Divine Moral Order principle which is the fundamentum of the Zoroastrian law is diametrically opposite to the idea of slaughter of animals. There are so many references in all the Avesta scriptures to the subject of Ashoi or holiness and law of divine moral order that almost all the followers of Zoroastrian religion are conscious of this one cardinal point of their religion. The small Ashemvohu prayer inculcates that Ashoi is the highest good, it is immortal bliss, heavenly bliss is to one who is holy for holiness' sake. Now we shall ask the writer of Zoroastrian theology who advocates slaughter of animals in the name of Zoroastrian religion. I. Is cruelty to animals an act of Ashoi? 2. Is slaughter of animals an act of Ashoi? 3. Is destruction of animals an act of divine moral order as preached in Zoroastrianism? 4. is killing of animals an act of furthering the prosperity of the universe? V. Is shedding of blood of animals on the ground an act of gladdening the Mother Earth? 6. Is touching the lifeless carcass of animals an act of holiness? 7. Is the offering of a putrefying piece of flesh of animals in the holy rituals an act of strict ashoy required by the Zoroastrian religion? 8. Does the officiating holy priest remain pure with his holy aura if he touches such a dead piece of nasu while performing the holy rituals? 9. Is the putting of dead nasu on fire as an offering an act of holiness? X. Does the Gathic prohibition of jishmorandan, i.e. animal killing, fall under acts of holiness? 11. Does the slaughter of animals form part of ashoy or holiness by means of which, according to the Avesta scriptures, we have to approach Ahura Mazda? 4. Entirely wrong and inconsistent meanings attached to some words and texts by the translators in order anyhow to preach the idea of slaughter of animals. I. The Avesta word jish, which is the genitive singular form of gau, which signifies bull or cow or cattle creation, has been translated to mean flesh or beef in order to bring in the idea of slaughter of cows. 2. The same translator Spiegel renders the word jish in the same sentence Thranfadranjish Shavastraheka, occurring in Farvardhan Yasht section and Jamayat Yasht section, differently as cow and beef respectively, whereas other translators Harles, Dharms Teeter, and Kanga render it as cattle. Gatha section, in the prohibition of jishmorandan of cattle killing, the word jish has been unanimously rendered as cattle. 3. Hence the meaning of beef or mutton attached to the word jish seems to be only to suit their own ideas of animal slaughter for food. 4. In the ceremonial formula Haumea Gava Bears Mana, the word gava, which signifies jivam or milk libation, has been in the same way wrongly rendered as beef. Along with pure spring water, the milk of a goat or a cow is an indispensable requirement in all Zoroastrian rituals on account of the five fradho or electromagnetic forces, e.g. Adhu fradho, Vanthvo fradho, Gaetho fradho, Kshayato fradho, Danghu fradho, enumerated in the Abhanyasht. Hence it is simply ridiculous on the part of the translator to associate dirty blood-dripping beef along with the sacred things like Hauma and Bearsma. Zoroaster himself introduced this Haumagava Bearsman method of ceremonial according to the Abhanyasht, and one cannot for a moment believe, if one has the slightest idea of holiness of Zoroaster, that Zoroaster could have touched a piece of beef in order to invoke the angel Aban. Such a barbarous idea of beef as the meaning of Gava in the ceremonial formula could only have been invented by the beef-eating translators of the Avesta, who are absolutely ignorant of the strict magnetic purity observed in all the grand rituals taught by Zoroaster. The sentence Jishudayangho Urvanam Yazamade, which really signifies we attune ourselves with the soul of the well-created cow, has been rendered by Dharms Teeter as meaning we sacrifice cattle unto the beneficial cow. Thus we obtain here the absurd idea of sacrificing an animal to an animal of the same species. The Avesta word Myazda, which from its derivation, mid, to meet, implies the medium of meeting or holy ceremonial offerings, by means of the pure magnetic currents of which one can be in tune with the spiritual forces, has been translated to mean man's in Gujarati, i.e. flesh. V. This is the most absurd extreme to which philology can stretch its speculation energy. Sound philology has nothing to do with sound. Two words of two different languages having a similarity of sound cannot therefore have the same meaning. 6. As for instance, hate in English means contempt, whereas the same word hate in Gujarati means love, but in English is an adversative conjunction, but the same word in Gujarati means solid. Hence the speculative philologists have very often committed absurd and unmeaning mistakes in the height of speculation. 7. A very strange reference to Vohumanyasht and Tishtrayayasht is also pointed out by the advocates of animal slaughter. In the whole Avesta religion extant, including the Gathas, Vendidad, Yasna, Visparad, Yashts, etc., this is the only reference which is regarded as a pivot of animal slaughter advocacy by the students of Avesta. It has not the meaning attached by the enthusiasts of animal slaughter, as we shall presently see, and the entire Avesta scriptures inculcate so many mandates against animal slaughter that the reference to Vohuman or Tishtrayayasht necessarily goes out of question. The one strange thing to be noticed about the question of animal slaughter is this, that those students of Avesta who stamp only the Gathas as genuine teachings of Zoroaster, and who discard the rest of the Avesta as pseudo-Zoroastrian, lay undue emphasis on this reference to vohuman or tishtrayayasht pro-animal slaughter, the portion which has been stamped as later Avesta. And now to the reference itself. The text is originally rendered as under, the Iranian countries may carry ritual gifts for him, i.e. vohuman or tishtrira, the Iranian countries may spread the bearsma or sacred twigs for him, i.e. vohuman or tishtraya, the Iranian countries may cook for him an animal of white color, or of good color, or of any one of the homogeneous colors. Anyone of ordinary common sense, if he were to pay patient attention to the underlying meaning of the paragraph above quoted, will be able to see that there is absolutely no advocacy of general animal slaughter as the biased students impress upon a lay reader. In this reference, a special ceremonial, not now known to us, has been recommended only for the propitiation of the angel Vohuman or Tishtraya. It is at least understood that the literal words cooking an animal have some mystic sense, for the animal is not of the ordinary sort, but of some special color. Besides, the species of the animal is not made clear. Why should it be only a goat or a hen, and not a horse, a cow, a pig, an ass, a buffalo, an elephant, a dog, etc.? Is a question naturally arising to a man of ordinary sense. Moreover, this animal after it has been cooked is not to be touched by unholy persons and by persons not following the religion in practice, and if it is partaken of by such persons, the entire country of Iran will be ruined and destroyed, as said in the very next paragraph of the same Yashts. Here then we notice that the animal cooked for Vohuman or Tishtraya angel is to be touched only by holy persons who practically follow all the mandates of Ashoi. This seems to be quite an evident contradiction of principle. The dead body of the animal is, according to Vendidad, called Nasu, or deteriorating matter, which makes a man polluted if he comes in contact with it, whereas in the Vohuman and Tishtraya Yashts the dead animal is strictly ordered to be touched by holy persons and not by unholy persons. Such a sequence of facts necessarily leads us to conclude that the paragraph in the Vohuman and Tishtraya Yashts has some meaning to be read between the lines, and it is very important here to remark that Avesta is not an ordinary spoken language, but a cipher language requiring the special key of its own for deciphering it, the key which is now lost to us. We see very clearly from this isolated reference to so-called animal slaughter in the Vohuman and Tishtraya Yashts that the Avesta students try to make out the meaning suitable to their own preconceived beliefs and fancies. Looking to this very closely, we find that the animal is to be cooked merely and not to be slaughtered. There is no word for killing the animal, as we find in the Gathic prohibition of Jishmorandan, or animal killing. Again, the literal rendering of the word pasu is very clear. From the Avesta derivation pa, to bind, it means the medium of binding or uniting together. But the translators have almost all of them rendered it as meaning an animal. Granting the meaning of the word pasu to be an animal, we find that in the Haftan Yasht or Yasna, there is an attunement desired with the same pasu or animal class. Now the question naturally arises, how can the same prophet Zoroaster have preached attunement with or harmony and love towards pasu in the Haftan Yasht, and slaughter or cooking of same pasu and cruelty thereto in the Vohuman Yasht? Moreover, what is most wonderful of all is this, that in the same Vohuman Yasht section, there is to be found a fine paragraph preaching salutation and love to Gav or the entire animal creation, benedictions to it, victory to it, food and clothing to it, industrious work for it. If Gav, which means the entire animal creation, includes pasu as one species thereof, how is it reasonable that pasu may be killed at the same time or in the same yasht where Gav must be protected and cared for? Hence we conclude that there are odds of references con slaughter of animals and animal sacrifices, whereas the reference in the Vohuman or Tishtraya Yasht is the only one isolated instance of so-called advocacy of slaughter of animals, and that too, as we have already seen, is not logical in meaning when the entire context is taken into account. Even if we grant that the reference to Vohuman or Tishtraya Yasht is pro-slaughter of animals, we are at a loss to understand the inconsistency between this isolated later Avestic advocacy of animal cooking, and the Gathic prohibition of animal killing, Jishmorandan, and the Gathic mandate of protecting the animal, Pasushthreda, or the later Avestic references con animal slaughter odds of which have been quoted above. Thus if all these pro and cons of animal slaughter and animal sacrifices are weighed in the pans of a balance, one can easily say that the cons of animal sacrifices so much overbalance the pro as to render the pro quite insignificant. Having thus seen the basic arguments independently from the Zoroastrian scriptures, we shall now look into the arguments advanced by the writer of Zoroastrian theology. It seems that in the book entitled Zoroastrian Theology, a reference to the subject of slaughter of animals is quite irrelevant, but it serves the writer in good stead since the writer wants to depreciate the so-called later Avesta from which he attempts to give such references pro-slaughter of animals. He says that Mitra is terrible when angered. Unless man appeases his wrath by abundant sacrifices, he punishes his wretched victim mercilessly. How would a lay reader construe these words? There is not the least idea of animal sacrifices and slaughter for the angel Mitra in the Mitra Yasht, and yet the writer has wantonly hinted at such an idea. The Asana offered to Mitra never implies sacrifice of slaughtered or living animals. A similar idea is got up with reference to Dravaspa. He says, Dravaspa is the female genius of the animal world. As the guardian of herds, she is invoked in company with Jishtashan and Jishurvan. In the case of Dravaspa, we see that with the exception of Hauma and Zarathustra, the other heroes, Hashyangha, Yama, three Tahana, and Hasrava and Vishtaspa bring to her offerings of 100 horses, 1,000 oxen, 10,000 small cattle, and the libations. Certainly these words have no meaning of slaughtering so many animals for sacrifice unto the female angel who is at the same time the protector and guardian of the entire animal creation. A similar wrong idea is to be found where the writer says, Jishurvan is invoked in company with Jishtashan and Dravaspa. Varethrakna, the angel of victory, complains before Zarathustra that the mischief of the demons and their worshippers increases upon earth because men do not offer sacrifices to Jishurvan. Throughout these references, the writer does not seem to understand the meaning of the term Jishurvan, which means the soul or spirit or the essential of the entire physical creation, including men, animals, plant, and mineral life. Moreover, the writer has a very peculiar idea about Zayathra and Yasna, or offering and attunement. That these Avesta offerings never imply slaughter of animals must be clearly borne in mind by the student of the religion, which stands on the foundation stone of Ashoy, i.e., ideal purity, and one would with very simple and plain sanity of mind admit that the slaughter of animals and the shedding of blood of mute innocent animals like cows, goats, horses, sheep and camels is never an action of purity proceeding as a result of pure words and pure thoughts. A reference with the following words. The priest at the sacrifice undertakes to propitiate a Shahina by sacrifice, if he has in thought, word, deed, or will offended him. Clearly shows that the English word sacrifice used by the writer is a misnomer, since the word conveys to any lay reader who has not opened the original Avesta text the meaning of slaughter of animals for sacrifice. In Yasna Hoftain Hadii, if one opens the text and reads the translation, one will be able to see that all the five periods of the day are addressed therein without reference to any idea of sacrifice unto them. The fundamental law of attunement by means of vibrations throughout the universe with every visible and invisible thing and force has not been properly understood by the students of Avesta, and hence the terms Yaz, Yasna, Yazamate, etc., which bear an underlying meaning of the law of attunement, are rendered by the writer of Zoroastrian theology as meaning sacrifice or slaughter of lower animals. One more instance of such reference may be added from page. There the writer says, Ahura Mazda and Zarathustra invoke her, Ardvisura, with Hauma and Bearsman, with spells and libations, whereas the majority of her other votaries severally offer her 100 stallions, 1,000 oxen, and 10,000 sheep. Here it will be seen that no slaughter of animals in such a large number is advocated in the case of the votaries, except Ahura Mazda and Zarathustra, of Ardvisura. The spiritual intensity of votaries is expressed in the metaphorical and allegorical terms of so many animals of the cattle species, and the intensity of the spiritual concentration and force of devotion employed by Ahura Mazda and Zarathustra is expressed in the terms of Hauma, Barazamsan, and Manthric vibrations, We are at a loss to make out why the writer of Zoroastrian theology tries to impress upon the reader the idea of the advocacy of sacrifice or killing of animals. A highly speculative, nonsensical, absurd, and misleading statement is made. Ha’Mashiak is to be propitiated with sacrifice. Among other objects, animals were sacrificed in the Zoroastrian ritual unto the angels, and the different parts of the consecrated flesh were allotted to the various yazatas. The Pahlavi books elaborately treat the question of reserving particular parts of the animal for the various yazatas. We are told that Ahura Mazda has set apart for Ha’Mashiak as his share in the sacrifice the jawbone, the tongue, and the left eye of the immolated animal. In general, this is also in accordance with the statement of Herodotus regarding the Persian acts of sacrifice in worship. If we refer to the Isna 11, from which the above fantastic statement is alleged to have been made, we find that there is not in the least any idea of slaughtering an animal. The Avesta runs thus. My father Ahura Mazda gave for Ha’Mashiak the sacred bread with the tongue and the left eye to be eaten. From these original words, the writer of Zoroastrian theology explains the principle of sacrificing or slaughtering animals for Ha’Mashiak. In Avesta, the tongue and the eye are very often metaphorically used, e.g. in the Gathas the prophet asks Ahura Mazda to teach him by means of his own tongue and mouth, and from this we must not construe that Ahura Mazda is made of flesh and bone and possesses a tongue of flesh. In the same way, in the Gatha Ahura Mazda is said to perceive always the entire creation by means of his two eyes. This does not literally imply that Ahura Mazda possesses as we do two eyes of flesh. In the Kershet and Mit Hrenesh, salutations are offered to these two eyes, which are of Ahura Mazda. All such allegorical and metaphorical language of the scriptures can never be taken to mean literally as the words stand. In the same way, the tongue and the left eye can never imply the slaughter of an animal, for the terms refer to some spiritual powers which ought to be developed by one who wishes attunement with Ha’Mashiak. In the Isna 11, quoted above, there is not the slightest reference to animal, and there is no word or idea suggesting the tongue and the left eye of some animal. The passage is so very mystic and parabolical that no sense can be easily made out of it. In the phrase my father, it is not clear whose father is referred to. And the sacred bread, the tongue, and the left eye are given by Ahura Mazda to be given to Ha’Mashiak. This leads us to an absurd conclusion that Ahura Mazda himself undertakes the slaughtering of some animal and then gives the tongue and the left eye of that animal to the angel Ha’Mashiak. There is no word for any animal in the Avesta text, and it is simply false to put in the word animal in order to pamper the favorite idea of slaughter of animals for sacrifice. This is the most absurd way in which the students of Avesta expound their sacred religion, derogating the most exalted teachings thereof in the eyes of the sane public. For such students it is fit to remember that where ignorance is bliss, it is folly to be wise. That the animals enumerated in the Avesta have not always the literal meaning of animals is noticed from the writer's own words. Tishtri mourns his defeat and complains that men do not sufficiently sacrifice unto him as they do unto other celestial powers, for had they not been sparing in their invocation, he would have been able to bring a further strength of 10 horses, of 10 camels, of 10 oxen, of 10 mountains and of 10 rivers to his side. Evidently here the animals are named only to convey the idea of the measurement of the strength intended, and in the same way in all the yashts when the devotees invoke any angel with so many animals, it is implied that the spiritual intensity of the invoker is measured by the strength of so many animals, and that no slaughter of animals or no bloodshed is meant for the sake of the angel. On the same page again, the use of the word sacrifice misguides the reader. He says, Ahura Mazda himself thereupon offers a sacrifice unto Tishtriya and thus imparts new strength to him. The words can never imply that Ahura Mazda offers the sacrifice of a slaughtered beast to Tishtriya. They simply mean that Ahura Mazda makes yasna with or attunes himself with Tishtriya, and thus by spiritual cooperation of both the strength of the latter is naturally augmented. Thus we find that the word sacrifice used so often in the book of Zoroastrian theology is quite a misnomer for yasna or attunement or worship or devotion. Throughout the Avesta we find allegory and metaphor in terms of animals, which do not literally imply animals. It is said that Sriasha drives forth in a heavenly chariot drawn by four white horses. Can there be horses in the unseen world where Zoroaster has his jurisdiction? We find. The soul created bull, the progenitor of the animal world, is invoked along with the moon. If the word implies literally a bull, it is absurd to say that Zoroaster has taught the worship of animals. The Avesta students seem not to have understood the underlying meaning of Gu used in the Avesta. The moon has its epithet Gauchitra, meaning seed of the world. This epithet reveals to us the function allotted to the moon in the economy of nature. The moon is the medium for transmitting all the spiritual currents for the nutrition of the entire physical world. It is quite plain that the physical world is nourished and perpetuated by the spiritual agencies working in the universe, which work through the medium of the moon. This is verified by the statement in the Manish that when the moon rises, all the green plants begin to shoot out from the earth. Modern science also teaches that magnetic fluid called odile continually rains down from the moon, and this fluid helps very much in the growth of the vegetable kingdom. Thus we learn that because this physical world is continually nourished by the spiritual forces, Chitra, the word Gauchitra is applied to the moon, where the word Gau signifies the entire physical world. Hence Avesta ought to be read between the lines in order to grasp the internal original interpretation of all the Avesta technical words and phrases. It will not be irrelevant here to refer to the Gathas in connection with the interpretation of Avesta. In the Gatha H.A., we find a very peculiar phrase running thus. Dasa Aspau Arshnavadish Ashtremcha. Meaning. 10 pregnant Marais and 1 camel. Now here is a text quoted from the Gathas which are considered to have been written by Zoroaster himself, even by the writer of Zoroastrian theology. In this the prophet addresses the Creator and inquires of him how to procure through holiness that prize which consists of 10 pregnant Marais and 1 camel. If this is literally true, no man of ordinary common sense can follow out the desire of the prophet to obtain 10 pregnant Marais and 1 camel. These 11 animals, if they are at all animals intended in the Gathas, cannot be regarded as an adequate prize in return for the strict adherence to the laws of Asha. It seems quite ridiculous to a lay reader to think for one moment that Zoroaster is anxious for obtaining these 11 animals as a reward from Ahura Mazda. He, after little reflection, convinces us that these words camel, mare, and moreover pregnant mare must have some inner signification of some higher spiritual powers desired by Zoroaster in return for and as a natural result of his living a life of austere purity and holiness. This one sentence from the Gatha suffices to hint at the utmost necessity of understanding the Avesta not alone by mere literal translations thereof, but also by means of some line of reflection laid down by the prophet himself for enabling the students to decipher the Avesta. It is always difficult for a reader, even in secular literature, to follow out exactly the spirit intended by the writer in his prose or poetry composition, and hence it is quite natural that unless some line of the interpretation of scriptural text has come to the knowledge of the student, scriptural text can never be expounded by means of ordinary lines of study of secular writings. Engrafting a student's own queer beliefs and ideas gathered as a consequence of some circumstances, either as idols of the mind or as idols of the marketplace, upon the scriptural texts themselves, can never amount to the original interpretation thereof. Hence it so often happens that the same text is interpreted in different ways by different students according to the various standards of judgment applied by them as sidelights. Sidelights may be thrown, but it is quite incongruous to throw the sidelights of secular knowledge upon the study of religious scriptures. This digression helps us to conclude that the entire Avesta is written in the mystical, allegorical, and metaphorical style with all the technicalities of its own, and that all the animals mentioned therein do not literally stand for such animals. On this one most important ground of argument, all the nonsense preached by the writer of Zoroastrian theology about animal sacrifices and offering the various parts of slaughtered animals in the sacred rituals falls to the ground, if a sane reader remembers always that as in every branch of science there do exist technicalities in the Avesta without a knowledge of which it is quite impossible to grasp the original and essential import of all the various Avesta writings. We shall now refer to some hideous and horrible teachings of the writer of Zoroastrian theology about the killing of animals and their dead flesh dedicated to angels or put on fire. He says, not on the authority of the Avesta text but on that of foreign writers, Strabo relates the mode of sacrificing to the waters. The sacrificial animal, we are told, is taken to the bank of a river or a lake, a ditch is formed into which the animal is killed. The pieces of meat are then placed on myrtle or laurel, and holding tamarisk twigs in his hands, the priest pours oil mixed with honey and milk on the ground and chants the sacred formulas. Great care is taken that no drop of blood falls into the water while the animal is being immolated, nor must the mixture of oil, honey, and milk be poured into water. This precaution is taken lest the waters be defiled. Another more horrid and absurd reference is found. Much of what the Greek authors write regarding such Iranian sacrifices in antiquity has its parallels in the later Avestan texts. Some of the angels seek consecrated cooked repasts of cattle and birds as offerings from their votaries. Generally, the victims used in sacrifice were horses, camels, oxen, asses, stags, sheep, and birds, if we may judge from Athenaeus' page. Xerxes is said to have sacrificed 1,000 cows to the Trojan Athena, while the Magi offered at the same time libations to the manes of the heroes. When that Achaemenian monarch came to the river Strymon, the Magi offered a sacrifice of white horses. Speaking about the mode of sacrificing animals to the divinities, Herodotus tells us that the sacrificial beast was taken to a clean place by the sacrificer, who covered his head with wreaths of myrtle. When the victim was slaughtered and the pieces of meat were placed on grass, the Magi consecrated them by chanting the Theogony. We have quoted these in the fourth chapter, where it is pointed out that the writer of Zoroastrian theology very often engrafts the ideas of foreign writers on the Avesta expositions, and that the ideas of these foreign writers are not at all verified from the Avestan text. If one remembers the fundamental principle of Zoroastrianism, namely, of Ashoi or ideal holiness and divine moral order of the universe, one can easily understand the absurdity and bosh contained in the above two references. At least from the point of view of Ashoi principle, one can never readily admit the validity of the above statements as applied to Zoroastrianism. This is the most absurd way in which the various students of Avesta endeavor to expound various subjects, by putting their own pet theories and beliefs gathered from various sources as if the Avesta religion taught these. The writer goes further in quoting the absurd nonsense from foreign writers, where he says on the authority of Strabo that the fire priest fed the sacred fire with dry wood, fat, and oil. Further adding that some portions of the caul of the sacrificed animal were also placed on it. A Zoroastrian writer and moreover a priest writer would consider 100,000 times the intensity of absurdity of such ideas of foreign writers before placing them in his book and concurring with them. But we have by this time been able to make out the underlying motive of the writer of the book, which is to run down all the Avesta scriptures in the eye of the reading public except the Gathas. On the very next page he contradicts himself by saying that Angramenu has created the inexpiable crime of burning or cooking dead matter, and the Vendidat enjoins capital punishment for those who commit it. If the Vendidat, which is one of the nasks of the entire Avesta scriptures given by Zoroaster, regards it a crime to put dead matter, Nasu, on fire, it is quite evident that the views of foreign writers regarding animal sacrifices are merely speculative and unwarranted, on which no sane writer can dare to rely as authoritative. It is very regrettable that instead of refuting such absurd views of foreign writers about the advocacy of animal slaughter in the name of Zoroastrian religion, the writer of Zoroastrian theology quotes them in support of his own beliefs about the same, with the only motive of derogating the status of the so-called later Avesta. Then last but not least, a provoking statement quoted from the Pahlavi book Shayist Lashayist is to be found. We must say that the Pahlavi books fall into two classes, namely, those derived directly from the Avestan books, and those which contain merely opinions of persons of much later times, and that therefore the Pahlavi books of the latter class cannot be put in the same category of authority as the former, which are mere versions of the Avesta. Furthermore, in Pahlavi as in Avesta, the language used is mystical, metaphorical, and to be read between the lines, and hence Pahlavi, like Avesta, must not be taken always in the literal interpretations. If the student goes merely through literal translations either of Avesta or of Pahlavi writings, he is liable to stamp all these writings as full of absurd nonsense, as the writer of Zoroastrian theology has done so often in his book. On the pages above quoted, he exposes such nonsense in the following words: We have already seen that meat formed a conspicuous article among the sacrificial gifts made to the heavenly beings in the Avestan period. Meat viands are the special feature of the sacred feast during the Pallavi period. The Pallavi treatise Shayast Lashayast explains what particular parts of a slaughtered animal are to be specifically dedicated to the various divinities in ceremonies. The angel Ham's right to receive the tongue, jaw, and left eye, recognized by the Avestan scriptures, remains still undisputed. The head and neck, shoulders and thighs, loin and belly, kidneys and lungs, liver and spleen, legs and tail, heart and entrails are all distributed among several different beings, until at last the tailbone falls to the lot of the august Faravahar of Zarathustra, and the great emanations of Ahura Mazda have to content themselves merely with the residue. This is no doubt taken from SBE Volume V by the writer of Zoroastrian theology without consulting the original Pallavi text. The Avesta and Pallavi words Gav and Gosh Hudeo have baffled all the translators, and Europeans in general are fond of rendering them into mutton, beef, or meat, whereas if various Avesta and Pallavi passages containing these words are closely examined, one finds that the words have far higher meanings of the animal world, life, the living creation, etc. The passage quoted above must have some higher sense behind it, for if it were taken literally as it stands with an offering of the offal of a slaughtered animal to various angels, it signifies at least that the idea is not one of Zoroastrian Ashoi principle unless the allegory is properly interpreted. The food and drink problem has been solved in the same book Shayast Lashayast Chap, 9 section SBE Volume V in the following words. After the departure of the light, let him not devour, with unwashed hands, the water and vegetables of Hormuzd and Amaradad, for it after the departure of the light thou devourest with unwashed hands, the water and vegetables of Hormuzd and Amaradad, the fiend seizes away from thee two-thirds of the existing original wisdom. Hence we see that Shayast Lashayast preaches in plain words the diet for a Zoroastrian consisting of water and vegetables, and there are passages prohibiting slaughter of animals in the same book. From such circumstantial evidence from the same book, one can easily see that the passage referring to the offering of various organs of a slaughtered animal to various higher beings in the ceremonials cannot stand literally as valid and sensible. Even a scholar like West makes observations upon the difficulty of forming opinion from these translations of Pallavi writings. Thus, in the introduction to the same volume SBE, omitting all consideration of the possible contents of the lost literature, it is obvious that the remaining 10/11 of that which is extant may contain much which would modify any opinion based merely upon the 1/11 here translated. What the untranslated portion actually contains, no one really knows. The best Pallavi scholar can never be sure that he understands the contents of a Pallavi text until he has fully translated it. No amount of careful reading can make him certain that he does not misunderstand some essential part of it, and were he to assert the contrary, he would be merely misleading others, and going astray himself. How far these remarks are applicable to the writer of Zoroastrian theology, who, not even being a translator himself, presumes to guide the Parsi public ignorant of original Avesta and Pallavi scriptures, it is left to the sensible reader to judge. One more point must not be left out of the same nonsensical group. The writer refers to the same foolish idea of slaughter of animals, and says, if the nation sacrificed unto Varetharakna with libations, and the sacred twigs, and consecrated cooked repast of cattle, either white or of some other color, no hostile hordes, no plague, nor evil of any kind would enter the Aryan lands. The sacrifice is to be offered through righteousness, and none but the righteous should partake of the holy food dedicated to Varetharakna. Untold calamity would befall the Aryan countries if the wicked should have a share in the sacred feast. We have discussed this statement before at some length, and here shall briefly say that in the whole Avesta portion extant, this is the only reference which the advocates of animal slaughter lay emphasis upon, attaching a very strange meaning to the word pasu. When the whole context is read with attention, one can readily see the absurdity of the idea of animal slaughter in a ceremony which is to be performed with piety and holiness, and which is to be partaken of only by professors of strict piety. The idea of animal killing and of cooking dead flesh of slaughtered animal can never be stamped as an idea parallel to the rules of Ashoi or holiness, whether physical, mental, moral, or spiritual, and hence we have to surmise that the context must have some other meaning and an ideal one. It may be that the context implies an idea of killing or cooking our animal propensities and the fruit of such cooking to be enjoyed by persons who practice holiness. Such a meaning would be nearer the entire context and would be in keeping with it, although we do not emphatically say that that is the original underlying idea of the context. We have already noticed that there are metaphorical and allegorical ways of expression of spiritual teachings in the Avesta only to give a pictorial suggestion for such teachings, and that therefore it is quite unscientific to take such expressions literally and word for word as they stand. As for instance, Zoroaster is said to drive forth in a heavenly chariot drawn by four white shining horses. The son of Ir has his epithet, or Vitaspa, i.e. fleet horsed. It is useless to multiply such instances of parables, metaphors, and allegories, but we learn from these that the study of scripture language is altogether different from the study of the language of ordinary prose or poetry. Having referred to the teachings of the writer of Zoroastrian theology about the advocacy of animal slaughter, we shall now refer to some general points falling directly or indirectly in this present chapter. While speaking about the Ha’Mashiak or emanations of Yahushuah Mazda, the writer of the book under the heading On the Material Side, Vohuman is the patron divinity of animals, says in the creation of this world, cattle are placed under the care of Vohuman. The follower of Zarathustra nourishes and feeds them, protects them from oppressors, and delivers them not over to cruel tyrants. It is such a one that propitiates Vohuman, for cattle are the counterparts of Vohuman, and he who is good to them reaps the benefit of both the worlds. Vohuman or Vohumanangha of the Gathas is the emanation of Yahushuah Mazda, next in rank to Yahushuah Mazda, and if he is the patron of the animals as said above in accordance with the true and genuine spirit of Zoroastrian teachings, one cannot for a moment believe that these teachings can include or even savor of the idea of animal slaughter for sacrifices to angels. These ideas have been quoted again from the Pallavi book of Shaist La Shaist above referred to. The idea of destruction of the animal world either for food or for sacrifice to the angels can never for a moment be classified as one of holiness, prosperity, or progress, the main principles of Zoroastrianism, and the advocates of animal sacrifices in Zoroastrianism are knowingly or unknowingly wrong teachers. The writer says further about this second emanation of Yahushuah Mazda that Vohuman, as the genius of the good mind, did not emphasize the faithful adherence to good thoughts, but contented himself with reminding the prophet to teach mankind to take care of his cattle. The writer wants to show that the original abstract concepts are later on materialized, forgetting at the same time that even in the Gathas the protection of the animal world is regarded as a function of Vohumanangha. No student of Avesta will deny the fact that Vohuman is the presiding emanation of Yahushuah Mazda of the animal world, and that the man who disturbs the order of the animal world by any sort of destruction displeases Vohuman and therefore Ahara Mazda also. The writer points out that one who has ill-treated cattle is ever trodden under their feet. We have given a very long list of references both direct and indirect from the Avesta in order to make the reader see that Zoroastrianism has never sanctioned animal slaughter in the name of religion itself, and it is quite natural that the slaughter of innocent animals should be regarded as a sin against the emanation of Yahushuah Mazda Vohuman. Lastly, we shall under this head refer to the question of diet, since the writer has wantonly passed remarks of a peculiar kind on this very important subject of Zoroastrian mandate of ashoy or purity. He quotes from the Pallavi Denkard. It needs only the final touch of this greatest of the renovators, Sayashyant, to bring about this result for the eternal welfare of the universe, Fras Hoggard. Men by this time, when these millennial conditions have been reached, have ceased eating meat, and subsist on milk and vegetables. In the age of modern scientific progress, it is admitted on all quarters that the millennium is removed further and further so long as the slaughter of animals for food is continued by the human race. Purity, peace, and progress are diametrically opposite to the ideas of decomposed matter for food, of cruel fight between butcher and animal, of taking the life which man cannot give. The idea of the millennium is taught throughout the Avesta in the Gathas, the Asana, the Visparad, the Vendidat, etc., and the ideal progress can never be achieved if man continues disharmony between his own kind and the brutal creation. On P, the writer refers to the celestial food and says that the food that is given to the souls of the righteous ones in heaven as soon as they enter its gates is the ambrosia, the spiritual food of the angels themselves. This is of course a metaphorical way of representation, but it signifies that progress, spiritual and ideal, necessarily implies progress of the physical body towards refinement and subtlety and purity, and that without physical purity spiritual progress is impossible. The writer does refer to the principle of physical purity and says that the mode of living of the Parsis as taught by Zoroastrianism, which enjoins bodily cleanness and hygienic principles as religious duties, contributes greatly towards the preservation of young lives, and keeps infant mortality at its lowest. If the writer properly understands the meaning of bodily cleanness and hygienic principles as taught in the Avesta, he will never advocate animal slaughter either for religious rites or for diet in the name of Zoroastrian teachings in the presence of so many Avestic references to the contrary given in the beginning of this head. The writer says that the foulest food is served to the sinners, and that the most fetid, putrid, and disgusting kinds of food are given to the sinners in hell, and these the wretched creatures devour in quantities but yet remain eternally hungry and thirsty. Brimstone and lizard, poison, and the venom of snakes, scorpions, and other noxious creatures, blood and filth, bodily refuse and excrement, impurity and menstrual discharge, dust and human flesh, dirt and ashes, form the variety of dishes that the infernal caterer supplies to the inmates of hell. Thus we see that blood and flesh are included in hellish food, which can under no circumstances be looked upon as holy food for the physical body. Of a professor of Zoroastrian religion whose watchword is holiness, physical, mental, moral, and spiritual. In spite of so many contradictory facts, the writer says that the Theosophists argue that Zoroastrianism forbids flesh eating. This is quite a mistaken idea and a wrong one. We have already seen that in the Vendidat and Tishtrayayasht the diet for man is defined to consist purely of the vegetable kingdom, and that in the Gatha XXXII, there is a clear prohibition for animal slaughter, and that in Gatha L, there is given a mandate for protecting the animals. In spite of such clear and obvious references, the writer of Zoroastrian theology ridicules by bringing in the name of the Theosophist all the purely Zoroastrian ideas, such as under animal slaughter for food is not consistent with the commandment of compassion to animals. But, above all, animal food is unclean. Man's spiritual growth is stunted by it, and the eating of animal food, as incompatible with righteousness, forms an insurmountable barrier to the spiritual development of man. No amount of piety can redeem him, and no austerities can free him from damnation. The movement is gaining ground among a considerable portion of both sexes in the community. As said, now under the heading Druje as the personification of bodily impurity under the name Nasu, the writer says that purity of body, mind, and spirit go together to constitute a righteous man. On page, as we have already noticed, Vohuman reminds the prophet to teach mankind to take care of his cattle, it is pointed out that the true follower of Zarathustra nourishes and feeds the cattle, protects them from oppressors, and delivers them not over to cruel tyrants. It is such a one that propitiates Vohuman, for cattle are the counterparts of Vohuman, and he who is good to them reaps the benefit of both the worlds. The writer declares, decomposed meat is not to be consecrated to any angel, that men by this time, when these millennial conditions have been reached, have ceased eating meat, and subsist on milk and vegetables. And then he puts in an unwarranted statement that the Zoroastrian church has never countenanced the vegetarian movement. We leave it entirely to the reader to weigh the pros and cons of this important subject as set forth in this fifth head, and then to arrive at an impartial conclusion deduced from the evidence herein. We have one more testimony to the pure diet preached in Zoroastrianism from the writer's own words. Orvidat is the giver of daily bread. On the material side, this emanation of Ahura Mazda has water for his special care, and Zarathustra is commissioned by this emanation of Ahura Mazda to advocate good use of it in the world. As water gives fertility to the land and is the source of prosperity, Orvidat is taken as the possessor of plenty and prosperity, and is invoked by the pious to bestow these gifts upon mankind. Food and drink are his gifts. It is said that the daily bread which everyone obtains in this world throughout a year is apportioned in the celestial world on the day orbited by their deeds, and that these offerings thus secure for the faithful a larger share in this annual allotment of earthly riches. Amrita works in the vegetable kingdom that belongs above all to him, and helps those who work for the plant world. Food and drink are in his care. The supervision of food and drink given to the end emanations of Ahura Mazda, Orvidit, and Amrita, Orvidit and Amrita of the Gathas, at once suggest the Zoroastrian canon of purity in food and drink, which must be conducive to the wholesomeness and immortality of body and soul simultaneously. Abstinence from flesh food of any kind and from spirit use liquors is the easiest logical inference following from the grand principle of Ashoy emphasized in the Zoroastrian scriptures. Yatha no ayangam shado maneo, vahishto urvano, kithravadish tanvo, hento vahishtam anghush akaskoit ahur yamazda jazantam, is the grand principle preached in Yasna H.A., of physical, mental, moral and spiritual progress intended as the summum bonum of life in Zoroastrianism. So that our minds may be happy and peaceful, our souls the best and our bodies radiant with the highest luster or aura, and with such highest point of progress being conscious of the best existence we may approach Ahura Mazda. It is left for the common sense discretion of the reader to say whether this goal of a life elision here in this physical body and in the physical world is possible if Zoroastrianism advocates animal sacrifices and unholy meat diet. But the jaundiced see always everything about them yellow, and the biased writers may try to dupe the majority of their co-religionists who are absolutely in the dark as to the original teachings of their scriptures, and may try to lead the public opinion by the nose under the glamour of diplomas of Western universities. Another testimony, though it may be indirect, regarding a pure diet for man is found. The soul is immortal, and survives the death of the body which is perishable. The ignorant man, intoxicated with the pride of youth, encircled in the heat of passion and enchained by the bonds of fleeting desires, forgets the transitoriness and death of the body. One who lives for the body alone comes to sorrow at the end of life, and finds his soul thrown into the terrible den of Angramenu. Man should act in such a way that his soul may attain to heaven after death. The individual who blindly seeks the passing good of the body, thus sacrificing the lasting good of the soul, is merciless to himself, and if he has no mercy on himself, he cannot expect it from others. This ignorance brings his spiritual ruin. He should not live in forgetfulness of everlasting life and lose it by yielding to his passions. If the physical life in this world is at all worth living, if life is real and life is earnest, then it is quite natural that in all the departments physical, social, moral, mental, and spiritual and even in economic conditions of life it must be lived in accordance with and up to the ideal goal lying in front of it. If the only object of this life in the physical world is the spiritual unfoldment of the latent powers of the soul, then it is quite necessary that all the activities of life re food, drink, dress, dealings etc., be made parallel and supplementary to the attainment of that ideal. If the ideal goal of life is a fact to be realized by all the souls on the earth and it is one as evinced by the Gathas and other branches of the Avesta scriptures, then it is quite plain that we eat in order to live or continue our physical existence in the world and that we do not live to eat or merely to satiate our lower propensities summed up in the five senses. What can be said of the writer of Zoroastrian theology who, in spite of the presence of such ideas of ideal life in his own book, says some untrue and unwarranted things in the name of the Vendidad? The man who marries and rears a family is hard working, and nourishes his body with meat, is able the better to withstand a stavidhotu than a celibate. This, as the writer says, has been quoted from Vendidad 4. When we refer to the original Avesta text, we find no word or words suggesting nourishment of the body with meat. It will not be wrong to say that the words with meat are, when rendered philologically, put thus: O Spitama Zarathustra, here accordingly I prefer the man who has a wife to a Magav or a celibate, I prefer him who has a family to one who has none, I prefer him who has children to the childless man, I prefer him who has happiness to him who has none. Indeed, the former of these two kinds of men well multiplies the increase of cattle, and he is better able to store up the good mind than one who does not do so, and he has a good memory. He is of the value of aspirina or of a medium-sized animal, or of a beast of burden, or of a man, because that man can withstand the bone-breaker demon and fights with him, he can oppose the demon who is a right shooter of arrow, he resists the demon of winter thinly clad, he offers resistance to the wicked unholy starving heretic. Thou shouldst practice the first kind of these deeds and not the second. If the original is closely looked into, one can see the absurdity of the idea expressed by the writer of Zoroastrian theology on p. There is no word in the Avesta suggesting the idea of nourishment with meat. It seems that the writer of Zoroastrian theology is ignorant of the original Avesta and Pahlavi writings when he quotes or refers to these in his book. He has borrowed sometimes wholesale the views expressed by European savants in the translations of SBE series, and sometimes even mutilates these to suit his own ideas. But he has never cared to go to the original Avesta text in order to make sure if the European savants have misrepresented certain important passages. Being a meat-eating race, the European savants cannot but see the Avesta from their own point of view. Editor's note, the Denkard accounts in Book 5, Chapter 31, when it is lawful in Zoroastrianism to sacrifice a sheep, reproduced thus, replies of Editor Farnbag 26. The reason of carrying forth the stick before the knife to the sheep, and of all other things that should be done in the matter, of slaughtering it, which refer to, sheep, other than that used for a ceremonial offering, is to remove from the body, of the sheep, the prevalence of several evil influences, drudges, namely, the much unpleasantness, literally malignancy and bad flavor of an uncastrated animal. As regards those sheep that are used in ceremonial offerings, Naranjiha, the practice also is not to slaughter a sheep unlawfully and oppressively, and, then, to ask for forgiveness about the slaughter of the sheep. Also by that process there is no terror and no pain unto a person from slaying the animal with the knife, but not oppressively, frequently, and, at all times should there be a desire to butcher sheep with dispatch. End of editor's note. The simple word gav has been translated more than once to mean beef, which is very repulsive to the idea of the Avesta scriptures. Where the Avesta word is expressly meant for the animal kingdom or cattle or the entire living creation, Darmstadter translates it to mean meat, mutton, beef, etc. In the passage of the Vendidad under discussion, some Avesta words which are easy of translation are rendered by Darmstadter to mean fills himself with meat. Yojish Uruth Verhampafriti, when literally rendered, imply who concentrates his protection of the growth of the cattle. Here the word jish is at random translated to mean meat, which is an absurd meaning, and this meaning is followed eagerly by the writer of Zoroastrian theology because it is quite palatable to him. The word Uruthver means growth or expansion or increase, and when the whole context is seen, one is quite confounded to see the idea of storing up of the good mind or vohuman by one who eats meat in abundance. In order to point out the absurdity of his own translation, Darmstadter puts a footnote that vohuman is at the same time the god of good thoughts and the god of cattle. If vohuman is such, what common sense will accept the diametrically opposite ideas of animal slaughter and of storing up good thoughts from vohumana by harassing him with the killing of animals for meat? The Pahlavi also renders it with the same view, namely, those people can entertain vohuman within themselves who keep cattle well, tender and nourish them. Philologically rendered, the phrase can be put thus, vohuman, good thought, jijirbush taro, can acquire, unhat, is, yo, who, jish, of the cattle or living creation, uruthver, increase, hampafriti, fills up. All these words, when literally analyzed, do not in the least suggest any idea of killing of animal for filling oneself with meat, and thus without referring to the original Avesta text, the writer of Zoroastrian theology blindly follows the unwarranted and wrong renderings of European savants, thus revealing lack of scholarly independent judgment. In fact, the entire book of Zoroastrian theology has been based upon the translations of Avesta and Pahlavi writings by Europeans, which are very often misguiding and incorrect, and this fact gives rise to the doubt if the writer of Zoroastrian theology has even the philological knowledge of Avesta and Pahlavi languages. And now to conclude this fifth chapter, it must be clearly understood that I. the idea of animal sacrifice in any form or the slaughter of innocent animals in the name of religious ceremonials is quite foreign to the Avesta religion as taught by Zoroaster, the teacher of Ashoi principle. 2. The Gathas have specifically inculcated the prohibition of animal killing, and have regarded all those who advocate Jishmorandan, i.e. slaughtering of the animal kingdom or of the living creation, as evil or opposed to Ahura Mazda. 3. The Gathas preach protection of innocent animals, Pasush Threta. 4. The word Yasna in Avesta never signifies sacrifice or killing of an animal, but that it is a term implying the grand law of attunement spiritual upon which the entire universe has been based, the sum total of the law being styled in the Avesta as Stayodayasna, the law of the original primitive existence as mentioned in the Gathas. V. The offering of animal sacrifice to angels is merely a dream of a handful of writers like the one of Zoroastrian theology. 6. The apparent passages of such references to animals like the Dasa Aspau Arshnavadish Ushtremcha, 10 pregnant Mares and a camel, mentioned in the Gathas, have some higher metaphorical and mystical meaning not understood by the translator. 7. Vohumana or Vohuman is the guardian angel of the entire living creation who can never be delighted with the advocate of animal slaughter and can never reward such with the wisdom spiritual of the good mind, which must be the desideratum of every follower of Zoroastrian religion. 8. Ashavahishta or Ashavahishta, i.e. the best, holiness and the law of divine moral order of the universe, can never tolerate the idea of animal killing, for any reason whatever, as one of Ashoi, i.e. holiness or moral order. 9. The law of highest purity, physical, mental, moral and spiritual, enjoined in the Zoroastrian scriptures, can never allow the adherent to swallow dead matter of a slaughtered animal for food. That the rule of abstinence from nasu or decomposing dead matter, so much emphasized by the Vendidat, cannot at the same time advocate flesh diet for a Zoroastrian. And, x, the principle of Urvatam Urunam or unfoldment of the soul longed for in the Iwisruthram Ga, which necessitates Kithravadish Tanvo or brilliant oral bodies, Shado Maneo or healthy peaceful mind, and Vahishto or Vano, the best condition of the soul, simultaneously, aspired after in Yasna, which is the sumyam bonum of a soul's existence on the earth, will never for a moment allow us even to dream that Zoroastrian scriptures advocate the killing of the animal kingdom for human needs or in the name of religious ceremonials. Hence, in spite of the 10 basic reasons of the Zoroastrian vegetarian principle, to say that Zoroastrianism has never countenanced the vegetarian principle as said by the writer of Zoroastrian theology is nothing but deliberate untruth.